occasion, we are having and unfurling the second session of our teachers training after a very successful first session, which we had four sessions in first series called Har Subject Kuch Kehta Hai. Now this is the first session of the second series. It is called as From Unsung Hero to Sung Hero, because every teacher is an unsung hero, and it is our strive, it is our quest, it is our earnest, willing step to make every teacher as a sung hero, because every teacher is a role model, is a matinee idol in the eyes of our children, and this we should keep it alive. We cannot have but an excellent speaker for the day, who is absolutely teacher at heart. And as few minutes before ago, she said, you know, oh, I have done many mad things in my life, and this is what we want to know, how to have that little mad zinc thing alive in every teacher, so that she keeps that particular zinc alive in every student of her, whereby every child looks up to her teacher and says, yes, she is my role model. Yes, I want to be like her. Yes, she is my absolute favorite teacher, because it's an earnest feeling in every human being, basic instinct, whereby every teacher wants to be alive in the memories of her students today, tomorrow, and always. With this, I welcome Dr. Arundhati Hoskari, but with a small formal introduction, which will be given by Namrata. Over to you, Namrata. And with this, I would like to share again, once again, gratitude to Dr. Seema Negi. Is she here, or has she gone to some other space? Seema Negi, who is absolutely insane person at heart, but very much there in her mind and in her brains. So nice to partner with you, Dr. Seema Negi, in this journey, the first session of the second series. So let's have this spirit alive throughout with us. Now, Namrata, over to you to introduce our today's speaker, our absolute personality. She's one of my role models, Dr. Arundhati Hoskari. Over to you, Namrata.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you so much, Urmila ma'am. Thank you, Seema ma'am. It gives me immense pleasure to introduce amongst us the speaker for today, Dr. Arundhati Hoskari. She is MSc in Zoology, MEd in Education Management. She is MA in English Language and Literature. She has done PhD in Education Psychology. She is trained in Cambridge in IB subjects. She has a leadership experience of over 35 years, out of which 21 years a leader role as a principal, director, and management representative. She's a lifelong learner and a passionate teacher. She's a freelance journalist and an author of two books. Her articles have appeared in national and international magazines. She has published more than a dozen of research articles, papers in national and international conference proceedings. She has received many awards and accolades on different national and international platforms. She is a linguist who converses fluently in 9 different languages. Her voice is recorded for UNO Charter in 3 languages and is on UNO website. She is a motivational speaker and a trainer. She has lucky to go through affiliations on and off job. Now, currently, she is a consultant in education for Cambridge schools and IB schools. Over to you, Arundhati ma'am. Thank you so much.
Hello. Thank you. Thank you for this warm introduction, and thank you, viewers, and thank you, Rotary, for inviting me over here. Well, whatever success I have achieved or whatever, you know, I am today, I am not going to give an Oscar speech telling that, wow, I was passionate as a child. I wanted to become a teacher. I had always dreams. No, I never thought of becoming a teacher. I was good in so many things when I was growing up, right from my childhood, that always, like, you know, the ideas kept on changing and shifting. Like, so it would be like I was good in singing. So once I thought I would become an artist, like I would sing, and, you know, I was good in acting and also I wanted to be on theater. So like that, it used to change, but it never occurred to me that I will be a teacher. Let me be very honest with you. I became a teacher accidentally. And I got married very young. When I was in TY, even before my results were out, I got married. But I had a very supportive family. And within a year, I got my son. So I was at home. And I was a part of a kitty party where one lady started telling me, like, you know, why don't you take a B.Ed. course? You're so bright. You're so intelligent. I said, B.Ed. for what? What am I going to do with that? She said, ma'am, you can become a very good teacher, like, you know. I just laughed at her. No, I have no such ideas. Then I came home. I said, as it is, I'm sitting. That time it was 1 year course. I'm talking of 1984. I said, all right, let me take a chance and see what it is. And my husband said, all right, if you want to learn, learn. If not anything, it will help our son. You're a young mother. You will be able to help a son growing up gracefully. That's how I took up. And I performed very well and I got first class in my B.Ed. And before my results were out, I got, a job in 3 schools. And I joined one girls' school, SSC school it was, but a very reputed and a good school at that time. And then my journey started. There was no looking back. There was absolutely no looking back. I started enjoying my career. I started enjoying teaching. I learned so many things. See, why I narrated this is, as children, sometimes we are not clear of our goals, what is going to happen and what I want to do. Some kids are very focused. They will know what exactly they want to do even in their primary years or, you know, secondary years. But I was not like that. I had a lot of plans except for being a teacher. But ultimately, I think I wouldn't, if you ask me a question today, what you would have been if you were not a teacher, I have no answer for that. I am cut out to be a teacher and I'm very proud that I became a teacher and I am a teacher. That's the thing. All right. Once I joined in, I developed my passion. I would like to narrate a small story what this passion is. Some of you must have heard that also. Like once a Socrates was going towards the river to take a bath in a public place at that time. And then what happened is one young man came forward. He asked him, and he was a great Greek philosopher. He said, please teach me philosophy. I want to become a philosopher like you. He said, all right, you want to be a philosopher? You want to know the truth? You want to seek truth? Then come with me, I will show. So he took him along and the young man walked. So Socrates entered the river and he also called this young gentleman and he came. Then he held his head. See, in those days, these Greeks had a very good body build. Socrates was nearly 7 feet tall and sinewy and hefty. And same thing with the other man also. He took his head and he dipped it in water and he just held him under water. So for 2 minutes, that man was really, really, you know, gasping for air. Then he removed him. He said, what are you doing? What are you doing? He said, now answer my question. When I had put your head in water, what was the thing you wanted most? He said, what a question is this? I wanted to be alive. I just wanted to breathe air. Then he said, the day you feel that you want to learn philosophy or you want to be a philosopher as bad as you wanted air today, that day you come to me, I'll make you the best philosopher. So what is the purpose of this story is, passion is the most important thing. As I told, I had no dream of becoming a teacher. Once I became, I embraced my profession and I developed my connect with it. I developed my passion with it. So passion, one, if you are passionate, then you can achieve anything, you know. And another thing, once I got into the profession, I was very, very focused in my work and my growth. See, I initially faced a lot of problems. Nobody's professional journey. Why only a teacher? Anybody. It is not going to be smooth. And especially if you are good in everything, you are bound to face lot of hurdles and lot of jealousy around. That happened with me also. But I also had good things, like, you know, I learned a lot. I became stronger. Otherwise, I was in a very cocooned and a very shelled atmosphere, like, you know, very well taken care. I didn't know, nobody would say anything to me. But when we enter the world of professional world, we come to know how to handle each character or each people. So I learned my administrative skills as I was dealing with people, I would say. So all my focus was on my work. When I entered the classroom, I would be like so happy. See, what happens is we have so many layers and so many hierarchies and so many things once we are out of the class. But inside the class, I was hero. I always went well prepared for the class and I thoroughly enjoyed and I dictated what I want to teach, how I want to teach, what pedagogy I want to do. So I'm talking of 85, 86. I was criticized for doing this. I started something new concept. There were some drab lessons where children wouldn't feel interested. Or, you know, like then I said, let me do it in a different way, like a flip classroom, what we talk today in digital world. I tried it in 86, 87 itself. I told the children, I would divide the children into groups. So four or five of them from each group, I mean, you know, they would come forward. And then I would say, the first two paragraphs you're going to learn. Second two paragraphs you're going to learn. You're going to do your presentation, how you want to say. You want to narrate it with a story. You want to form a skit with your friends. Everything is up to you. But you need to teach that thing. See, sometimes it was about the zero fights or about the environment. I used to teach mathematics and science. Okay, so anything you want, you could teach. So children really started developing that connect, because all the time sitting on the benches and hearing a teacher is a boring thing. When children are actively involved, then other girls, I would tell them, okay, now without, I don't want you all to put them down or, you know, try to tease them or anything. You have to come out with proper questions and you ask the questions. Let them answer. If they are not able to answer, I am here. I will answer. So that class used to go so well. But, you know, it was not very much appreciated, but I didn't care. Like, it was my area. How I want to do, I wanted to do. Whenever they had any difficulties, I would always explain. And then I came out with a lot of innovative things. See, in those days, there was no Google. There was no technology. And there were actually 85, 86, when I started teaching, there was no photocopying machine also. One cyclostyle machine was there. On that, notes and question papers used to get printed in the school. That was the situation. So how to teach in an innovative way? So I always used to carry some chart papers and, you know, the pens and whatever. So even the wet color chalks and wet, I would wet them and immediately, you know, draw on the things. And then I would show. And also like involving the children, especially in mathematics, I used to involve the children in different ways. See, my basic graduation was in the South. I studied in Karnataka up to my first degree. Then we moved on to Bombay. So my schooling was in Karnataka. There we not only learned multiplication tables, we also learned addition tables, subtraction tables, and along with multiplication tables. So for me, what is 8 plus 6? Here, when I ask this question, children would count like this on the finger. I don't know how they do it. They do it very quickly, but I'm still unable to do. For me, 8 plus 6 is 14. Or 18 plus 17 is 35. So we had to have that mental capability. So I started teaching the thing. Now also, like, you know, I have put so many videos on YouTube where shortcut methods for mathematics. Mathematics, I think, when we move away from South, there is some kind of phobia in children. They feel that maths is a very hard subject. So I always advocated, no, maths is the easiest subject because you don't have to learn anything. You don't have to, you know, there are no spelling errors. There are no big sentences. All you have to do is concept and logical sequencing and understanding. So I would do. So why I'm bringing this is I used to get into innovative pedagogies. So every day my effort was to make the lessons more interesting. And I never considered anybody else as my competitors. There were teachers who were better than me or not better than me. I never got into that game. I always competed with my own self. Today, I did this. Now, the same lesson, if I have to teach, how I can teach in a better way. Or tomorrow's lesson, what innovative practices I can bring. So this way, I started doing. And I would make the buddy system. And then
tell the children, throw a problem at them, solve sums, and then put some problems. And then I'll say, if you are unable to do single-handed, then two of you sit together, but both of you should be able to do. I will call any one of them and ask you to solve on the board. So this way, by motivating, I started teaching. And also, I think I was the first one to begin using colored chalk, at least in my school that I know. I bought one colored chalk box. I had gone to Matunga and I saw them for the first time. That was in 80s only again. I brought it because I used to teach these theorems, like, you know, great, all these chord and other things, tangent theorem and everything. So it's a kind of abstract subject, geometry. So what I would do is, I used to use different colored chalks to mark the angles and mark the sides. And that went so fast and children started loving the subject. Being dressed. I never like, in the name of simplicity, I don't like sloppy kind of thing. So what I used to do is I always went with the proper, well-dressed, and because we are role models. See, for models and actors, they are only facing the stage, or there are retakes and takes when they are shooting for films. But we are actors, always live performers. Every day is we are in front of so many audience. Our audience is our own children. And they are, trust me, children are also our critics. They observe everything right from tip to toe. What kind of sari you're wearing, what kind of dress you're wearing, how is your hairdo, everything. Let them observe. I was happy about it. I commented on that. I always believed in being well-dressed, and I always go in a very, very well presentable manner, I would say. That is another thing. And next thing is, like, you know, I accepted the changes, whatever happened in the pedagogies and the technology. I embraced them and then I moved forward. See, today, people of my genre, I feel sometimes irritated. That's why I cannot connect very well with such kind of people. They, except for that WhatsApp and Facebook, they don't know anything. They don't know what is Google Form. They don't know what is Paint. I'm not saying you become a tech expert. Even for that Facebook also, if the picture is to be uploaded, they will call the children. It is not that they are unable to do. I'm not saying that. But there is no willingness to learn. See, when there is a change happening, you embrace the change. I learn. And also, like, you know, computers, they teach themselves. You don't require anybody's help. It's a self-learning mode. You get into self-learning mode and then you learn. So every change, whatever happened, like, you know, earlier it was, we started using the projectors, and on the transparencies we would write and use. And that was a big innovation. And then came the, you know, TV and this Educom series. They helped us in screening the things. So that came in. And later on came the smart boards. Today we have interactive boards. So, I was very comfortable in using all the things, and not just that, and I always trained the teachers. And when I became the principal, way back, around 2 decades back, I started training the teachers on my own, because the first assignment what I got was, I was a founder principal of a school. I had to establish the institution from scratch. So there, actually, we cannot be asking for a lot of things, because admission, everything was growing, the institution was growing. I used to sit, and after the school hours, I used to sit with the teachers and train them. I trained them in Excel, I trained them in PPT, how to make an interactive PPT, everything. So that is the passion. I'm not saying that I'm very big and I know this, I know that. It's not that. Every leader has to imbibe, every teacher has to imbibe. And not just that, if I didn't know something, I don't mind approaching anybody and learning. I'm a very open-minded person. I will tell you, when we enter into international education system, really our horizon expands. So you really start becoming open-minded. And today, especially, we are living in an information age. Today, if somebody comes to me and asks me something, if I'm hesitant, if I'm insecure, if I don't teach, what the person will say, all right, ma'am, it's okay, you don't teach, Google is there to teach, or so somebody else is there to teach. Information is at our fingertips. Then why have that insecurity? I never had it even before this information revolution. But today, though, like, you know, there is no question. I just don't get into that. Anybody coming, I go out of my way to explain and make the things. Because for me, I have always, as a leader, pursued my growth as growth of my team. If my team members grow, then there is a proper growth. That is my growth. That is my, you know, perception. And another thing is about the children, I have been always compassionate and very sensitive to their needs or to my students. My students are my world, I would say. And this has actually helped, this attitude of mine has helped me touch so many lives. And let me tell you something, that actually the children suffer a lot in this adult world. Some of them, have broken homes. Some of them have financial problems, or some of them may have other behavioral issues or poor health or health issues at home. You never know what background the child is coming from. So I never used to, harp on a child and make them feel that. The minute I would come to know that motherly compassion would flow and I would understand them, I would sit and guide them. So that way we have to handle children. I would like to quickly quote two or three examples. There was this kid who had tried to change her marks. She had got, I think, two marks, digital marks in one subject. She had made it 22 to appear like, you know, pass. Like it was, the paper was out of 50, a midterm exam. And unit test. So then I caught her. I didn't say a word when the paper she came to return. Immediately I could make out, because I never gave out the papers to children without entering the marks. Not just that. See, I learned my own things. Whenever I made my mark statements also, what I would do is questions would be there. And for every child, how much marks she has scored in each question, I would write. So there would be no question of cheating. So immediately I caught. Then I sent the entire class, went out for a break, and I made this child sit. I told her, I know you have changed the marks. Why you have changed? No, ma'am, I have not changed. I said, come, open the paper with me. So everywhere, 0, 0, 0, 0, 0. How she will make up 2 as 22? Then she started crying. And I didn't say a word. I said, I will just let you go if you say this is the last time you're doing it. I'm not going to escalate. I'm not going to penalize. Is that a promise you're going to do? She said, ma'am, I will never do it. Please let me go. Please let me go. You can write 2 only, but you know, don't tell it in the class. I said, no, my promise. I will not make a big issue out of it or ridicule you in class. I will not do it. And I won't even hold back against you. Don't worry. So I let this child go. And today this child is a completely successful lawyer. And I had forgotten about this incident. Actually, what happened is, about a month back, she got to me through Messenger and she narrated the whole thing. Ma'am, this is this. I had no courage to come and confess this, and now I'm doing it. I'd like to talk to you. Would you share your phone number? You tell me. My joy knew no bonds. Like, you know, actually, this is my real earning. This is my real asset, I would call. Then there was another child who was completely, who had flunked in. She was in grade 10. She had flunked in her exams. Like science, she had got digit marks. This child came. And when questioned and all that, she said, no, I know I'm not good enough. Then mother said, ma'am, please take her tuitions. You can guide her. I said, no, sorry, I don't have time. I don't take. Then she insisted. I said, okay, I will sit with her and guide her if you want. But, you know, you have to bring her to my place. I was staying in Worli. Mother said, no, I will bring her to your place, ma'am. Please guide her. So when I was guiding, I came to know she was being tutored by my colleague, one of the teachers of the school only. See, nobody is right, nobody is wrong. The other teacher found her not good enough, and she had suggested, in fact, open schooling for her. And the child, when she narrated this, she started crying with tears drizzling in her eyes. She was very good in languages. She was doing well in other subjects. Then I told her, look here, you are not dumb. So you remove that from your head. You will definitely pass, not just pass, you will pass with good marks. That is my promise. Trust me, the few sessions I took, more than teaching her science, I boosted her self-confidence and I gave her the tricks to study, where to write. So I told her, if you want to explain about the process of, nervous system or a digestive system or whatever, like, or even if for that matter, Newton's law or any extraction, whatever you want to do, you remember the picture and then start writing. So simple guidelines I gave to that kid, but more of the time I boosted her self-confidence. She not only passed her SSC with distinction marks, today she is a very successful journalist at New York. She pursued her studies from USA and she's a very successful journalist over there. So we never know what are the potential of children. I have never labeled a child. I have never discouraged a child. There was yet another kid, like, you know, she came, I was a principal at Billabong and she tried to reach me over the phone. Phones were not directly, I don't receive the calls. No, my receptionist, for some reason, it was not transferred. Then she sent a letter. Ma'am, I was your student. You remember you had helped me in my maths and I have you are the one who kindled my passion. And today I'm a successful finance personnel in MNC. I'm working. I finished my, software engineering and then finance MBA. I was so happy. And then she had written, ma'am, I just want to come and say, thank you. I have a son, but he is already admitted. I'm not coming for admission. I felt so bad. Why children should feel that, you know? Yeah. Then I quickly replied to her, even if you come for admission, I will not mind it. If I am in a position to help, I'll help you. You're my child. Come over. And she came and she presented a book to me, The Outliers. And that precious book is still with me. That's how I developed Connect with Kids. And another child who is now professor in London, she also used to face a lot of problem with digit marks and all that. And I helped her. So these kind of things, why I'm not trying to gloat over myself or, you know, tell big things about myself, but compassion and sensitivity towards the students is the most important thing I would want any teacher to observe. That is why I said. And another thing is, like, you know, I always kept myself away from the cliques in the staff room, because otherwise I wouldn't have achieved what I wanted to. Because people around you, whether you are a teacher, whether you are a superior, whether you are a head of the institution, if you are good in everything, people around you feel insecure. I feel sorry for them and leave them to them. I have no enmity, no friendship, nothing. Whenever anybody comes to me, I help genuinely, but I am focused on my work. And all my degrees, everything I have studied after my marriage, managing my family, managing my son, managing my work, I manage the stuff. In fact, my interaction was mainly with the adults and children, like, you know, 8, 9, 10 groups, like all the time I taught. I was very fascinated when I was healing. Psychology, somehow I'm very, very inclined to human behavior. That is the reason I enrolled for PhD when I was 50. And I was already heading an international IB school, a baccalaureate school. So everyone, my friends and all were laughing. What is wrong with you? Now, what are you going to do with this PhD? I said, what do you mean? It is for me. I'm not going to bargain for my pay. I'm not going to get any benefits, nothing. I know that. But it is for my own pleasure because I have been, in this profession and I have dealt with teenagers. So in fact, my thesis was on the behavioral problem of teenage children, adolescent children. And I correlated that behavioral problem with all the four strands, like anger, self-concept, anger, aggression and anger, depression and disruptive behavior and anxiety. All these four strands, how they affect the self-concept was my topic. And that's how I enjoyed my journey. And my guide had told me 700 to 800 kids you can do, but I studied, the sample size was around 1500 I studied, and I was very happy to do, because there was no other external motivation. I was internally motivated. So every teacher, I would say, need to have that internal motivation. And also all the professional development, I never waited for the school to sponsor my thing. I was very clear. If I want to learn something, why should I wait somebody else to pay and force me to do? It's okay. And I want to do it for myself. I spent money and I did it. Like, you know, all my professional development programs, I have done it with the passion and I would go and really do. So this is a continuous learning. I'm in fact a lifelong learner. It is not just the degrees that what you see. Actually, all the conferences, especially the Cambridge conferences and all, when we go, we meet the educators across the world. See, I click a lot of pictures, but that's not the only thing I do and come back to India. whenever I attend these things. I interact every minute I get, I will utilize it, you know, that there are trainers, there are, you know, I would actively participate in the sessions, and also I would connect with people, how is their culture, how they will deal with the problems. So it is a wonderful learning. So learning happens everywhere. And even locally also, any such things come in. So always I get into the learning mode. So as long as you are in learning mode, you are going to be a good teacher. So there is no doubt about it. And even now, like recently, like about 6 months back, that was my dream. I wanted to do this diploma, like ACTL diploma in public speaking from Trinity College of London. 25 years back only I used to do, but last two decades have been so hectic in my life. All the time I was, you know, building up the institutions, enhancing the institutions. So I didn't get time. It was a very taxing job. So what happened is, like I said, why not now? So I did it, and I just missed my distinction, but I performed very well. I'm proud about it. And right now, another exam I had given 2018, I had enrolled for Yale University Emotional Intelligence for Teachers exam. And that also, I did the certification. In fact, last week I received a mail that I am among the top 1% performers. So that is such a great thing for me. So I find pleasure in these things. As I told, I am my own competition. My competition is only with me, not with anybody X, Y, Z and other things. And also I have always kept some people as my role models, and I have tried to emulate them. One of them is Sir APJ Kalam. He was a brilliant scientist, brilliant teacher, but such a humble person. And I was extremely fortunate to meet Kalam sir twice in my life. And once when I was a teacher, once I was a director of an institution. But you know, my position did not make any difference to this good soul. He treated me with the same love and affection. And I don't know, I am very much influenced by him. And the other person who has really impacted my life is Dr. Kiran Bedi. What a woman she is. And I was fortunate to meet her also and interact with her also. She is another person. So you can consider, these are my role models. You could consider anybody who come in contact. And also another thing, there are two men very strong in my life who have supported me throughout my life, is my husband, Govind, and my son, Tapan. Even to this day, I consider them, without their support, I wouldn't have become anything. That I'm very clear. So they are rock pillars in my life. My family is my strength, I would say, in whatever achieving, whatever I have achieved. And another thing is, like, you know, Urmila mentioned about the crazy things I do. Yes, I am interested in so many things. I don't know, I'm wired like that. I see something, there is a child in me, very, very active. I see somebody doing something, I feel like learning that. And I'm not ashamed. I will go even to a 5-year-old, and if I don't know something, I will ask them, you know, how to do it, come on, tell me. So I'm interested in art and craft and music, and I draw and paint right from the childhood. And I have given my solo exhibitions also. And I sing. I have learned not a very great training, but some initial training I have taken. I can sing both Karnataki style and Hindustani style, both styles of Indian classical music. I'm very fond of dancing. So, and you know, and then writing, journalism is my another passion. In fact, my first story was published when I was 16 years old. And that I had written on an adult topic. So everybody started calling my dad, and we want to see this girl. We want to see this, your daughter who has written. How old is she? Where is she working? My dad told, no, she's just a kid. She's just 16. So very passionate about writing and everything. And that I have continued. I published books. And this is again, you know, how I manage my time is, one should be excellent in time management. I don't like people who grumble all the time, I don't have time, I don't have time. See, time, everybody, I also have 24 hours, you also have 24 hours. If you want to do something, you have to sacrifice. See, when I did my PhD, my work was so hectic. Morning, once I reached the school at 8 o'clock, till 5:36, I would be completely involved. I wouldn't get time to look here and there. I used to get up in the morning. I am early riser. So 4 o'clock, I would get up. 4 to 6:30, 7, I used to study. And then I would go. Same thing in writing books also. I manage my time. They are me. That is me time. You know, I don't get distracted. I don't get derailed. And mental traffic is at the minimum. So I plan my day in advance. If I have to do whatever I have to do tomorrow, I jot down. whether it is at home or whether it is at school. So that actually keeps me, so I manage my time very well. That's why I'm able to, you know, do so many things. And I take everything seriously. I don't take anything as a casual or a joke, you know. Even today, I mean, sometimes what used to happen is, even when I was a director of a school, some teachers have not come. The classes are without teachers. Teaching is my first love. I would enter the class and I would teach. And if I knew that teacher has planned a leave, I would prepare for that lesson the next day and I would go. And we would come to know early in the morning which teacher is not there and all. So I would just quickly browse through and gather my thoughts and go, and my lesson would be really good. Even today, I don't require to really, you know, if I have to teach grade 8 or grade 9 ka science or maths, I don't have to revise and rehearse. But I never believe, I never, go into that mode. You have to be perfect, try to be perfect so that your time is managed well. Whatever I want to convey, I should be able to convey during that time. That is the most important thing. So I manage my time pretty well, and that is the reason how, you know, I'm able to manage so many things. So when there is a passion, you will be able to do so. And also this profession has given me so much more than I could have imagined. See, we used to, as a teacher, so I used to get a lot of holidays. Even as an administrator, when I moved on to head of school, then also we had holidays. We had public holidays. Then, you know, Saturday and Sunday off. So all this time I have utilized for my talents and my hobbies in a very meaningful way, without neglecting a family. Family is my first priority. But, you know, I don't believe in just sitting and talking to people on phone for hours together and chatting without the content. I can't do even to this day. If there is something to, you know, talk and understand each other, whatever, like if it demands, I can talk. But simply, I can't discuss recipes. I can't just talk and while away my time. I feel I consider a waste of time. How I've been living my life is every day we are nearing death. So today, if I lose, I have lost one day of my life. That is my attitude. You know, that has really helped me. So there's so much to read, so much to understand, and so much to, you know, make a difference. I want to write, I want to paint. So everything I'm able to manage only because of this. And then, you know, like, as I told you, these holidays, they gave an excellent opportunity for me to pursue whatever I wanted to do, because time also is a very important thing. So at the end, like if I have to sum up for every teacher, if I have to give a message to the teachers, you know, don't kill that child in you. However old you are, as old as you think. See, I have met people who are 17 years behaving like 70 years. They are in the first year and second year of college. So how are you? Yeah, I'm good. I'm so bored. I don't know what to do. I'm so bored. I say, what is this? The body is 17 years physical and 70 years mental, I would feel. And I have seen people who are 80, 85, still walking, wanting to write, wanting to do. Those kind of people also. So what I say is, like, it is up to us, up to every individual. You are as old as you think. I never want to be reminded of my age, because you tell me where I'm lacking. I'm doing everything what, you know, a 30-year-old can do. Then why should I bother about my age? So as long as energy is there, so you have to keep that active in mind. And another thing is child. Keeping child in mind, alive, means what actually does this mean? This is like having that innate curiosity to know and experiment things, learn things. See, for me, I have taken a lot of risks as far as my career was concerned and reached where I exactly wanted to. But my goal was very clear, where I want to reach, what I want to do. And also, like, you know, I'm not going to boast that everything I do, there is a divine grace also. Things fell in place and I got the right opportunities, but I also took calculative risks. So teachers also should learn to take proper risks and proceed further and have a clear-cut goal and you work towards that goal. See, I can sit and imagine and dream today that I want to become Prime Minister of India. But what am I doing to reach that stage? That path, road map should be very clear, and you have to, whatever you want to do, whatever, wherever you want to reach, you have to start taking baby steps together as soon as you, you know, set your goal. So that is another message I would like to give. And compassion is the most important thing. It is not just you being compassionate. Teachers have to make the children realize. Teach them sharing and caring. Teach them. See, we are living. Unfortunately, our kids are living in a world. Everywhere the dialogue in the mind of people is what I can get out of this situation. I mean, what I can, how this can benefit me. You know, we make friends depending on that. We make anything in life, we always look at that. That's a very bad thing, you know. So, and then we tell children, you have to be honest, you have to help people, you have to be philanthropic. Children may not tell you, the kids who are very small, who can't, you know, combat anything with you, they may not say, but what goes processes, information processes in their head? They observe us. So what I want to say is, if we want to improve this quality in children, we first have to behave it that way. So we have to teach compassion. We have to tell their children, the message of adults to children should be very clear. Don't always think of what you can get from the situation, what you can get from your country or society or individuals or from your home or your friends, but try to think what you can give, what I can offer, in what way I can help. See, help is not always a money or big help. Even if somebody is in distress and somebody is upset, if you talk to them nicely and give a moral support, and that is also a great help. That is what is needed at that time. It's not always the kinds or money or anything like that, or making big favors. I wouldn't call it as favors also. So it could be small little things like this. The children will develop compassion. And empathy is another quality. Whenever we say, "Arey bechara, what happened? You know, this shouldn't have happened. That shouldn't have happened." Nobody in the world wants your sympathy. And sympathy is the worst thing you can give to any human being. You don't have to be sympathetic. You be empathetic. You try to put your shoes in their, you know, your feet in their shoes and see where it pinches and help them. So this quality of empathy, we need to embed in children. That is another message I would like to give. And then honesty, the core basic values. See, honesty also with small things. Say, for example, children are, I have kind of things, but kids tell, you know, when especially the small children. So when you, what happens is children are taken on a holiday for a day if they wanted a family outing. Next day a note comes in the calendar, my child's tummy was hurting, so I couldn't send. And so one day this little girl came to my office. Often she used to take holidays, and the teacher brought, she was in primary class, I was a principal. She came to me. So while talking very nicely, I started talking to the child and all. In the excitement, the child blurted out, ma'am, yesterday we had gone out and we had a brunch in the 5-star hotel and this and that. I just smiled. I just sent. I didn't say anything to the child because it's not child's fault. Next day, I summoned the parents. I said, no, she had a tummy upset. Then I told, see, if you honestly tell me one day I want off, she's not appearing for IAS examination now. She is in grade 2 or 3, I don't exactly remember. I said, one day if you want, have a family time. There is learning everywhere. Even if she goes out for a lunch or a brunch, she will observe so many things over there and learn. That is okay with me, but don't teach this. See, on one hand, we tell these children, we have this casual attitude, chalega, like, you know, write and send, so that teacher won't scold. I said, what kind of example you are setting in? See, these things, parents are not wanting to spoil their children, but this automatically happens. But remember, your children are watching whatever you do, how you are telling. So actually, you need to be very sensitive how you behave. By telling this, and then we tell children, no, you have to be very honest. You can't do this. You can't do that. You do this way, then that won't work like that. You have to be exemplary. Or the same thing, when you are driving the car, like there is no police cop there and the traffic is not there. So you will just move ahead, even when it is red. The child is observing. So, following the rules, why we are actually having a lot of problems in India is our civic sense is very, very poor. See, it is always let my house be very clean. If I throw the garbage outside, it's okay. Now with the Swachh Bharat Abhiyan and all that, lot of things Modi ji is doing, and that's a very good thing. But just I'm telling you, I've seen people going in BMW and Mercedes, throwing the chocolate wrappers out of that. And what is the use of your wealth and BMW if you don't have a basic civic sense? And you keep it in the side pocket and throw it in your dustbin. So these are all the things we need to instill in our children. And the teacher's role is also great here, and as well as adults' role. So ethics are, you know, exemplary. Actually, children should observe us, our honesty, our behavior, our truthfulness. So the teachers also need to be in that set role. Okay, I will, you have to be very careful. As I told, we are all like actors on stage. There are no takes and retakes. Whatever we make mistake, that cannot be undone. So these are all the things we need to keep in mind. And that's it. Like, you know, and there are so many people who help in your journey, who create trouble also. But you have to be focused on your career and where you want to reach. But whenever, you know, like I got an opportunity, I'm very proud. I can make this statement. I have not harmed anybody. If I could help, I have gone out of the way and helped. Otherwise, I have just kept to myself. And especially in the professional circle, I have not harmed anybody. I have never been a threat. Some people, if they perceived me as a threat, that is their unfortunate feeling. I can't help it. But even for those people, I have always wished well. So if our conscience is clear, if our goals are clear, and if we wholeheartedly help others, you know, then there is no looking back. According to me, what I feel is, who is a real good teacher? A teacher who imparts knowledge or whatever her, you know, understanding capacities, everything she imparts unconditionally without expecting anything and without holding it back. There should not be insecurity in our mind. That there has never been insecurity in me. That, okay, if I teach this, then, you know, she will become more important. He will become more important. Then where will I be? I have no insecurity about knowledge. If anybody else grows and if they are groomed, I'm very happy. Whether they acknowledge or not, most of them have acknowledged. It's not that people are ungrateful always. So many of my students, even till this day, and colleagues, they always mention whatever they learned, and they hold me as their role model. And that is, again, the grace of God, I would say. I'm not boasting about it. But that should be the attitude. I think with this attitude, anyone and every one can reach where they want to. And I'm extremely, you know, grateful to God for reaching me wherever I wanted to. Because we may struggle, we may be intelligent, we may be there, but if we don't get those proper opportunities, it's not going to happen. So otherwise, I also would have just retired as a teacher in the same school or whatever, but I took risks, and those risks worked well, and I have no ego, or I have no, you know, any arrogance about that. I am very humble to the tune, and everybody approaches me. I think with this, I conclude.
So, Dr. Arundhati Ma'am, I think while you were narrating the entire story of your life and your student and everything, my life just passed in front of my eyes like a journey, and I was so very happy, because there was something which was bothering me since morning, and it's all about calculative risk, and it was like I was in two minds, I have to take that risk or not, and trust me, I'm taking that step tomorrow. So because I do that
all the best,
often.
Yes,
thank you so much. So it was there, which was there in my mind, but I truly believe, and I'm so very happy listening to each and everything that you said. Trust me, I tell everyone, like 10 years back or 12 years back, if I see the school I had joined, I was a grade 3 class teacher there. I was a class teacher for grade 3, and I used to teach the highest class. That time it was 7. And in that school, only after a year, I grew to coordinator. After 3 years, I grew to HM, then vice principal, and now I am heading that very own management's next school. And within 3 years, we have done our affiliation also. We have more than 1,000 students. Yes, I did work hard. Like the way you said, I did not waste my Sundays. I did not let others grow. I feel so happy and humbled when a teacher grows more than me. That gives me immense pleasure.
I mean, Seema, something, Seema, there is no shortcut for success. Success is always a journey which is really, really not easy. So we need to work hard. I always tell everybody, there is no shortcut for success. You have to tread that path carefully with all the determination, without getting deterred by anything that comes in your path. So I agree with you. Hard work is the only thing that takes you wherever you want to reach.
So, Urmila ma'am, I'm so very humbled now jumping into the other session. And I'm so happy listening to you. I'll get connected later. I have to quickly jump to other session. Thank you so much.
Okay, thank you so much. Thank you.
Okay, thanks. Yeah, this now the floor is open to the teachers. We have 9 minutes. So if any questions or, you know, if you want, it's absolutely free flow. You can ask any kind of question. And I'm sure Dr. Arundhati Oskari will answer you to your satisfaction.
Yes, this floor is open.
Hi.
Okay. Yes, Aditi.
Yes, ma'am. Honestly, I haven't attended the full session. I have jumped into in between. But whatever part I have heard, it's so beautiful. And before I say something, ma'am, you have a very beautiful smiling face. I love it. Please. I truly believe that we all should carry that same glow on all our faces all the time. We actually miss that.
Thank you.
And the best part is that, ma'am, I really am happy and cheerful to meet you today, because the bookish principles of the teaching and all which we have studied everywhere, you have explained them so beautifully in a simple terms by sharing your experiences and all. It's all there, everything which every rule you have followed, and you have explained it so beautifully. So
thank you.
It's a lovely thing how you have managed yourself. While all the hurdles have come up, it's a very beautiful example. Really nice meeting you. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, Aditya. Thank you. Where do you teach, Aditya?
Ma'am, I am in Kanpur having my own school.
Oh, that's great. Huh.
So I'm also looking after the pre-years and the teaching early years and the primary years.
Okay. So you're still growing.
Yes, ma'am. But by the grace of God, blessed to be connected with all the educators. Really blessed to be connected with you all.
Are you definitely. Anything I can do for you, I'll be happy. You can connect with me.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
Yes.
Good evening, ma'am. It was a wonderful session, and you have really taken us to a nice journey along your life, and it was so touching and so great. I'm so touched. I'm very happy to hear you. God bless you. And you really keep smiling. And this beautiful face keeps smiling always.
Thank you, Anita. Thank you so much.
You're welcome, ma'am.
Yeah. Good evening, ma'am. I am Neha Kiran from Visakhapatnam.
Okay, Neha. Good evening.
Yeah, good evening, ma'am. And it's very, very, I'm really blessed to be here today. Listening to you, you are so humble. You are exemplary things that are related to your life experiences. It really give all of us a lot of more support, and we get, yes, we can also do it.
Thank you. And, thank you. Every teacher has that potential. Every teacher,
yes,
can,
ma'am,
do.
I'm just aspiring to become a head of the institution. I would like to get some ideas from you, a little bit suggestion. You already gave us a lot of information.
Definitely.
If any other message you can give us so that we can become the best heads of the institutions.
Definitely. See, first thing, like if you are asking it, you can connect with me later. That also is there. But see, actually, if you want to be a head now, be among the teachers. Don't create that curtain or iron wall in between. Because the minute you make them feel that you are away from them, they will never confide in you. You have to think of the team. You have to groom, take everyone under your shelter and then groom them. That is the only trick, you know, if you want to be a real good leader. So you have to use mixed styles. All the time, we can't be democratic. Tomorrow, if you become a head of the school for everything, you ask, okay, what you will say? If she says something, I will do. If he says something, I will do. Then they will get the message that you don't know anything. It shouldn't happen like that. It's a very tricky situation.
Yes,
you'll have to use a mixed bag, you know, where sometimes you need to be democratic. Sometimes you have to put your foot down. No, you have to do it like this. But whenever you even say something firmly, it should not look like an imposition. Give a complete justification and explanation. Make people realize that why you are bringing something in, how it is going to, you know, benefit them, and definitely they are going to understand and they will really start loving you. See, if you win over the trust of your team,
then, you know, it is a wonderful journey for any head of the school.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you a lot. Basically, as you said, we should be moving from I to we.
Yes,
and
yes.
Along with that, taking as a team, we should have that capacity and capability to describe and discuss about ourselves what we are going to do.
Yes, yes,
be
definitely.
Reasonable so that.
Yes, yes. See, what happens is all the time it is not know-all attitude. It's not that only we know and others don't know.
Yes.
That's the wrong attitude. So sometimes we may get very good suggestion from where we least expect. But if you like and jump on the idea, there's nothing wrong.
Yes,
we don't become small by accepting others' ideas. You develop on them. So, but make it a collaborative kind of an atmosphere that really takes out. You know? But yeah, that is what.
Yeah, absolutely, ma'am. I even take the suggestions of my students and I involve
very
them.
Very good. Yes.
So they feel.
Students are there. All yeah. stakeholders for that matter. Students, parents and teachers, your own staff and management.
Yes, yes,
so you have to see the holistic picture, what suits best and how it is going to, larger picture, where it's going to help, that strategy we need to follow.
Thanks, ma'am. Thanks a lot, ma'am.
Welcome.
Anyone else? We still have 3 minutes to go, or we can just say thanks. Okay. Fine then.
Thanks to Urmila ma'am and Seema Negi ma'am to bring out such wonderful sessions, ma'am. I really follow all these things from all the four. This is the fifth section, I think. That's really wonderful, ma'am. Urmila ma'am.
Thank you, Neha Kiran. Yeah, it's a pleasure to be with you. And as Dr. Arundhati Huskari ma'am said, you know, just trying to touch everyone, trying to do a little bit of ourselves for the society and our contribution to the society, to this world, to make this world a better place. Because I know I was a school teacher for 18 years, how we really have a world with us in our classrooms and how impactful and how empowered species every teacher is. So this is just, and I'm very happy that Dr. Arundhati really awakened our latent, dormant, empowering attitude, empowering capacity, empowering capability in us. And I'm sure as we say goodbye to you and goodbye to every teacher over here, we are far, far richer from this session. Thanks a lot, Arundhati ma'am, for being so gracious and without any airs, accepting the kind invitation, being here and sharing absolutely the gem of your experiences.
Thank you, Urmila. It was my pleasure. I got to meet so many people, and anything for my teachers, anything for education, anything for children, whatever I can do, I'm always there. And thank you for inviting me over. And it's immense pleasure, I would say.
I'm going to trouble you more, ma'am.
No, it's not a trouble. I will be more than willing to share.
Ma'am, please share your email.
Ma'am, your email ID, ma'am.
Please share your email.
Put it on the chat because I don't know your email ID by heart.
Okay, you want me to put it right away?
Yeah, yes, you can put it right away, or I can put it on her subject, which whatever it is on the wall.
Okay.
Yeah, better, ma'am. Anything.
Anything. You can put it right.
Where do I write?
Yeah, in the chat box.
See, this is my email ID, ahoskeri5@gmail.com. I will also give my number, but you know, you please message me rather than directly calling, because I'll be handling so many things, and I will definitely reply to your message or answer your call. And email also, if I don't reply immediately, don't get, don't think otherwise, I will definitely get back. With this mobile, there was once a time I used to remember 200 phone numbers by heart. Now I can't remember my second number. So much of dependence. That's so sad. So,
soothe everyone, ma'am, now.
0-5-8-5-6. See, brain is so intelligent. Where it doesn't want to take load, it doesn't take.
Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah.
Okay. I have given my number also. You can chat with me over there. I will answer the calls, but if I don't answer the calls, think that I take a lot of sessions. See, all these new schools which are coming up and the schools which are getting converted into IGCSE or IB. So I do consultations for them. I conduct teacher trainings. And so it's a pretty busy schedule. That's the thing. And plus, I have so many other crazy things which I follow. Writing, painting, this, that. So time is little constrained, but I'll definitely reply if I see the message.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
Okay. Thank you. So,
thank
have
you.
A great evening. Have the a great evening.
You very too. Inspiring yeah. session.
Yeah. So see you again coming Friday, same time, 4:45.
Okay.
Bye-bye.
Thanks. Bye. Good evening. Yeah. Have a nice evening, all of you.
Yeah, all of you. Yeah.